Ngowi TV, informed economies and business perspective.
I mean long term, medium term, but then long term. And a long term, what have we said? It's a period of time. And we are saying within economics, really, this long term is a period of time when we have time to maneuver. It's a period of time when things can change. It's a period of time when we can maneuver. We can increase our production because we have room to maneuver, for example, when it comes to acquiring new machinery, new equipment, expanding production production plants, you know, those kind of stuff. If you're talking about the production possibility for here, it's a time when we can move outside the car and produce more depending on the demand. And we can use this really to advise the policy and policy areas, for example. I've said several times, for example, if you have now recently, we had the scarcity of industrial sugar in the market. It's not a question of saying, yes, there is a deficit of 100,000 tons, so go to the market and just produce more. It's a long-term thing. You have to plan for that. Maybe you need more funds, you need more machinery, more equipment, maybe you need more technicians, you need more labor to start producing. So it's a long-term thing, no? And we said, this is really a subjective, really, it depends on what you're talking about. The other time we talked about the Amaranta. And I asked you, never go to Mamantili and give me Ugali Amaranta. Amaranta, what is Amaranta, my friend? What is Amaranta? Mchicha. We said mchicha. Now, mchicha, within a month, I can prepare my farm. I can plant. It can grow. It can mature. I can harvest. I can sell. Yes, within a month. So 1 month really is a long time. It's a period which is long enough for me to do all those maneuvers. You know? But then when you talk about the production of cement, the production of new 100,000 tons of sugar, you know it will take time. Mr. President, here we are Baresa, is it Baresa? You know, I don't know what I'm saying, this piece of land. It will take time before he prepares, he plants the sugar cane, he harvests, he starts producing sugar and having more new sugar tons in the market. It's a long-term thing, relatively speaking. You know, so I think we spoke about those kind of a lot. Short term, again, in this period of time, when most of variables are actually, they are not variables, they are fixed. In this period of time, when we don't have so much flexibility, we cannot maneuver so much. We cannot just increase new production, new tonnages of cement, new tonnages of sugar in the market tomorrow. We say, for example, producing professors is a long-term thing. It's a long-term thing, you know. Some of us, it took over 20 years of studies for becoming professors. So, if you want to become a professor from now where you are, assuming that you are not in the system, you have to become a tutorial assistant for 3 years. You have to become assistant lecturer for 3 years, and not as much, but you have to produce a lot, you have to publish and all this. You don't publish, just keep my time. You have to become lecturer 3 years again. And this is a subject that you produce, you have to become senior lecturer. So you have covered almost 15 years. Become a professor, but now you should be producing. So you can see it's a long-term thing. Now, how did we discuss this? We said the other time, it's not a question of bringing in new university and thinking that we'll also be having 10 new professors in town. You get my point? You'll be circulating the same ones that you have been in the system. So you see its applicability. You see how you can use the theory of a long-term, short-term to advise policymakers, decision makers, you know, if for example the government says you are allowed to study only university, but come with your new professors. Don't check the ones that are in the system now. You can see it's a long term thing. It takes time to prepare them, you know, this kind of stuff. So, and of course, now I'm assuming and more or less, I'm almost pretty sure you cannot become a professor because the last PhD. So, in the first place, you finish your master's and you take almost 2 years now. You enroll into a PhD program, it will take you, if you are very lucky, 3-4 years. I have a master's, one of my PhD students. He will graduate if everything goes on well when he is 73 years old. Yeah? Because he started around 69 or so, and he has lost 1 year. So, you know those kind of stuff. It's a long term. Now you understand, my friend, long term, short term. I want to understand, you to understand its applicability. I'm not interested, I'll never ask you to write short notes on the long term, short term. I want you to advice and kind of help. You know exactly how you use it. You know, when we got an interview just many years ago, that's when we kind of we talk about, you know, write short notes on defining, etc. Again, within production theory, we are about to call aggregate production function. I will not really use a lot of time here, but then when I talk about the aggregate production function, we are talking about summation of all the production functions in economy, very theoretically. It's a sigma, you know, the sign, you know, the sigma thing. And of course, we say in practice it's impossible. Because if you are sigmaing, if you are summing up a production function in the economy, all of them, at the end of the day, you get nothing. Because you have the production function of water, plus production function of cigarette, production function of maize, at the end of the day, actually, you get nothing. Because, you know, these things here are quite different. At the end of the day, you don't get anything.
And so I don't like you so much time. You talk about now, that's very essential, you talk about production techniques, and this is very essential.
Production technique, and here we are talking about two major techniques: capital intensive and labor intensive production technique. And this here is very, again, very applicable, a part of economic theory, managerial economics. And what is the point here, friends? We say when we wanted to produce goods and services, we will use factors of production: land, labor, capital, and intervention. For analytical purpose, we normally use land, labor, and capital. Labor and capital, just really for analysis, for discussion. We know we need more than that. So the question is, once we want to produce, we have options. We have options. We can use land, labor, or capital. But indeed, in the real world, it's not the question of either labor or capital. It's both labor and capital. Now the question is proportion. The question is how much labor, how much capital. That's where we get labor intensity or capital intensity. Now, if you choose a production technique which uses more capital than labor, we call it labor capital intensity. If we choose production technique that uses more labor, we call it now labor intensive. Now, what does this mean? Because the story is just half-cooked without going into details. So, what is labor intensive? Labor intensive is the opposite of capital intensive, right? And you never tell me that. For master's level, that's what you teach. So, when I'm talking about capital intensive, we are talking about production technique, which involves automation, using machinery, automating production system. You know, using robots, you know. If you follow it, those who have been following the World Economic Forum at Davos in Switzerland this January, from January 26th to 28th, you know, part of the debate that came is the question of employment and the question of, you know, labor intensive, capital intensive. Indirectly, of course, they came. If you listen to Jack Ma, this richest man, one of the richest men in China, would tell you, and others, of course, they'll tell you, for the up to 2030, almost 800 million jobs will be taken by machines, by robots actually. Why? Because captains and titans of the industry, producers, will be automating their production system. Production will be more capital intensive than labor intensive. You know, it will be more machinery, more equipment, more robots that are producing goods and services, as opposed to labor intensive. Labor intensive is is, you know, use of muscles, use of you know, what you call casual labor, etc. But then capital intensive is you know, exactly what we are saying. And we are saying this now, it's very important in the debate on employment, in the debate on jobs creation. Because what Jack Ma and others are telling you is if machines are going to take to kind of wipe out 800 million people in, you know, in the world out of jobs, what does this mean? It means, again, we have to learn new skills. In the labor market, we'll no longer be competing with a fellow human being only. We'll also be competing with machines. And what's the point? The point is all the jobs that are routine and repetitive, that's very important. All the jobs that are routine and repetitive will be given to machines because you don't need to think so much. You just automate things and it goes. I've been telling you, friends, you are masters, and I've been joking. If you are traveling from Salaam to Yoma at this level, you have passed the Tabora. You have passed Tabora towards getting your master's degree. So you are almost there. Now, the point is, and I've been telling you, the bakers, for example, if you are a milk tailor, please, after master's program, I don't like to see you at the table. I want to see you at the back, at the decision-making desk. Why? Because, you know the teller machine. After a while, it's too repetitive and automatic, you know? And I used to joke and understand, well, even if you train an elephant, it can stand, it can sit at the tailor, and it offer the service that we are offering. You get my point? Because there is no thinking, actually. After a while, I've been joking some people in the name. They even know Jonathan, when he comes, you only draw 10,000 shillings. So you come, you have not even filled the withdrawal charge, they give you 10,000. It's so automatic, yeah? example, there are so many things, you know, this guy comes, always in my classroom, you enter, he subscribes you to our university, because it's too repetitive. We know the answers before you ask the question. You get my point? Avoid that. In the future, my friend, all those jobs will be taken by a machine. Will be taken by a machine. So what does this tell you? Really, you have to be very innovative. You have to be very, you have to be beyond the game, ahead of the game. You have to be a multitasker. You know, one of those days when you'll be doing everything. Machines will be here now. There are vehicles which are driverless. You know, we have now, for example, robots. We have drones, and Ngowi has one. We can stand at the room and take a photo, and we can go without having somebody who is kind of running it. You get my reference. So that's where the world is going. So what does this tell you? Really, you have to start inside. Maybe not you, but maybe I see your children and your children's children coming to that reality. 2030. You want to be retired, it's only tomorrow, you know? But then machines are going to take your jobs, unfortunately. Or fortunately, depends on how you look at it, that is happiness. So the question is again, we have discussed this in the context of universalization. And you know, if you read President Magufuli's speech in the parliament on the 20th of November 2015, he tells you he wants Tanzania to have industries that will be producing jobs for people. Very good. Now, if you are discussing what does this mean, this by and large, they have to be enabled in this industry. Those are the industries that will be producing many jobs. But indeed, an automated capital this machine, you know, a factory like this one, if it is textile factory, you need only two people to press a button for production process to go on. You get my friends. So that's the way. So really, these jobs will be coming from the value chain. And I think that's exactly what you should be advising management. You know, they'll be coming from producers of cotton, from my drivers, from my TVs, in the value chain. That's where the jobs will be coming. They won't come from these modern, updated industries as such. ATM, you guys, I have the list. I know there are a lot of bankers here. You know, the ATM, automatic teller machine, they came on yesterday. Those of my age would understand in those value days, if you wanted to draw a 1 year manpower in order for you to get a ticket. I know that's why. I travel a lot, if it's Gecko, if it's Denver, if it's Oslo. If it's a ticket, if you have to buy a ticket at the counter and the human saves you, it's more expensive than when you go to a distilling machine. What's the theory? The theory is labor is expensive. It will be replaced by alcohol. We have, you know, where you can go and dispense water, can get water, yeah, you just put your coins and then you get water. That is what we call automation. And this is the central thesis under production theory. So friends, you will see, I think I've said almost everything here, what I'll be telling you, never rise to the respect of this, but you understand what it means. I've given this example several times. I was in Saudi Arabia in 2006, 11 years ago, and specifically in Riyadh. And we visited a farm. What's going to be this is in your handout, a Maraya farm, where you have almost 7 cattle farms with almost 10,000 cattle each. We are talking about 7,000 cattle in a farm. And it's not managed by maybe 2, 3, 4, 5 people. You get my point? Everything is automated. The feeding system, the washing system, medication system. We went there, you could see the milking system. You know, when it comes to milking time, they'll come there and then the machine comes in and somebody presses somebody something and then they get milk for a specific period of time and every cow is labeled and you know for this time it has given this much liter and it goes to the production system, you go through the factory. After a minute or so, you get the yogurt at the end of the farm. You get my point? And this is something that we saw in a living life. It's not a story, it is Amaraya, it's Saudi Arabia, I was there 2006. We went to what you call the Gulf Investment Forum and had a presentation on investment opportunities in Tanzania. So you know those numbers. And there are quite a number, we don't have many time to do that. In Kuranga, there was a farm. Unfortunately, I'm not thinking that it's really turned down. A guy from Denmark and Tanzania. Partly automated, not totally automated, but again, you know, the feeding system, the watering system, you know, that kind of stuff, the cleaning system, automated. So what we're saying, these things, my friend, are here. Again, for example, Mzumbe Dar, again, seeing the production system, which is partly automated, you know, from the way, you know, the trees are being harvested, you know, the way they are cut into pellets, you know, the way they are packed. Really, you hardly see human being there. You see machinery. You see, you know, the plants and equipment, you know, and then, you know, in the handouts, I think you see more, you know, leaders. Now, just to go again back to the production theory, what we call the least cost production. What are the issues, friend? Under least cost production, we are saying, you guys will be making decisions on production of commodity X, Y, Z, you name it. But then from the economic point of view and from the theory of the firm, we want to profit. So what you have to do is to minimize the cost. You should combine the factors of production in such a way that they give you a least cost production so that you produce at a point where the production cost is the least, the production cost is minimum. In other words, I'm insisting that you should produce, for example, that's what's called isoquant curves, that is, these are curves that will show a different combination of various factors of production, but giving you exactly a combination of factors of production that can be used to produce given quantity of output with a given state of technology. That is the isoquant. You know, I don't like to go so much into detail, because again, I've said this is really repetition. I'm skipping, again, some of the details, because at the end of the day, of course, you have to move to a list combination of inputs. This is exactly what I want. List combination of inputs. Remember, you are producing. When you are producing, what are you doing? You are using factors of production, land, labor, capital, and entrepreneurship. It's not a question of taking as much land as possible. It's not a question of taking as much labor as possible. It's not a question of taking capital as much as possible. The question is combining them in appropriate proportion. In appropriate proportion. And in the context of cost, you have to do what we call now a least cost combination of factor production, where of course you have various proportions. Now the key issue is how much do I take of capital and how much do I take of labor in order to make sure I am producing at the least cost. I think those are the key concepts that I want to understand. I was skipping some of the issues. We come to factor productivity and returns to scale. Factor productivity, that is really the key issue. Friends, remember, you are managerial decision makers. If you are making decisions, you will be taking decisions that are made by others. And some of the decisions that you have to say is, should I employ this factor production? Once I have employed this factor production, should I keep it using it? Should I lay it off now? Should I let it go now? Part of the answers will depend on productivity. The question is not just the question of having factor productivity or production. The question is, how productive is it? And we will be talking in relative terms. You know, like land productivity, labor productivity, managers productivity. So productivity really is, we are talking about the output as measured by input that you give. So labor productivity, for example, it will be, you know, for given labor that I'm employing, how much is it giving me per unit, let's say, in a month or in a day or in a week. So friends, the question is not the question of being as busy as possible, the question is, are you productive? It's not the question of coming to work and stay for 8 good hours. The question is, have you been productive? And productivity, level productivity, is a function of so many things. Partly is a function of education, is a function of working environment, is a function of experience, is a function of a support from others. It's a function of age. And it depends really on the sector that you are in. I normally give this example in the world of football. In the world of football, productivity really diminishes very quickly with age. My friends, when I'm looking at you, I don't see anybody who can get a place, the men that are here, I don't see anybody who can get a place in Manchester United. Why? You are too old. You are too old. But I easily see guys who would absorb very quickly in academia. Why? You are too young. You get my point? So it's relative, come on. We take Jonathan, we take my friend. We are sure for the coming 40, 50 years, you can still be productive in the academy. In the world of football, my friend, don't try. Even don't try to become a coach. And that's why I tell people, Peter Schmeichel, Roger Miller, why Roger Miller at only 40? Why was he a phenomenon? Scoring a goal at the age of 40, a little bit of 40 plus? Why? Because it's football. A professor who is 40 is very young. I'm over 40, but I'm a relatively young professor. You get my point? If I were to play football, I'm a very old football player. You get my point? My productivity in football would be very low, partly because of age.
And of course, sometimes productivity could be a function of age, it could be a function of education. You guys, having equipped you with your master's, with you, if your master's, once you graduate, not now, of course, even now for the what you have equipped you, you we are likely to see you being more productive. So education, experience, skills, but also working tools, working environment is very essential in enhancing human resource productivity. So it's up to you again to know, when are you more productive? Some are more productive at night, some are more productive during the day, some are more productive in a very quiet environment, you know. Some will never be productive if there is no noise around, you know. Some will tune the music to the highest volume. That's when they can really absorb things. You get my point? So it's up to you to find. Now the question will be, in managerial decision making, you know, you are manager, or rather you are in the board, and you know, you have to convince your board to increase salary as one of the factors that will increase productivity. You know, the question will be, you know, why salary increase is one of the important factors in increasing productivity. Why working environment improvement is a necessity? Why having air conditions in our office is not a luxury, but it's a necessity in increasing our productivity. You know, those kind of stuff. So this is the part of application that I want really to you guys to use. And I think, as I say, productivity, for example, land productivity, it will be, you know, how much are we getting per acre. And again, land productivity is a function of so many things. And I want you to think broadly speaking, you know, land productivity could be, yes, 1 acre of a land, how much maize they get, will depend on fertilizer, will depend on the seeds that they are using, will depend on planting time, will depend on the distance, of the space, you know, those kind of stuff. So it's up to you guys to know how do you use the theory of the productivity in your behavior. Now I'll go directly to something again on returns to scale, and I'll go really to examples rather than explain it here. And on returns to scale, what's the key concept? The key concept here is, remember you are producing, and when you are producing, you are using factors of production, land, labor, capital, and technology. Now the question is, you know, I will be increasing factor inputs. The question is, my friend, for the factor inputs that I am using, am I also seeing factor output increasing? You may increase inputs only to get reduced input. I may double input and I get more than double output. That is good. I may double input and then I also get double output. That is good. I may double input and I get less than double output. That is bad. I get my point. So in economics, you have to think about those kind of stuff. It's not a question of just pumping in inputs. It's not just a question of pumping in capital in the business. It's not a question of increasing human resources. The question is, what is it giving me in terms of output? So for example, under increasing returns to scale is the situation where I double inputs, but then I get more than a double of output. That's the situation I tell the students, I study for 1 hour, I score 40. You say, only 40, I study for 1 hour, let me double. I study for 2 hours, instead of scoring 40, 80, you have doubled. I score 90, you have more than doubled. You just doubled input in terms of time, you more than doubled output, that is good. You say, well, Professor Ngowi, I study for 1 hour, you give me 40, now I'm studying for 2 hours. You get 80, so you double, it's okay. You say, Professor, I'm studying for 1 hour, you give me 30, I'm studying for 2 hours, you get 10. I'm getting the point. You double the effort and then the output, less actually increased. That's what's called diminishing returns. And normally the diminishing returns in this situation, if you see diminishing returns setting in, really stop producing. Exactly like you guys, I'll tell you, it's only because of opportunity cost you're not supposed to be here, you're supposed to be at home. But now you have to be here. You know, when you are tired, if you are not absorbing, if you see that you are not giving material, a pack and go home. Don't just sit in the library. You know, the point is not the hours that you sit in the library. The point is how much do you understand for the time that you're in the library. You get my point? Yeah? So I expect you to go home after this lecture. And you normally don't go home. Why? Opportunities.
Ngowi TV, informed economists and business perspective.